This is a new day. I'm calling out the mighty hero. The forces that are for you are greater than any force that's trying to stop you.
And we believe today, God, that you will do what only you can do.
He calls you a barrier breaker, a prized possession.
Welcome. It's always a joy to share God's word with you. And today, I believe that there will be a supernatural healing. I want to talk to you today about pearls in your pain. The pearl of great price. We all experience pain in life. When we were born, we came through pain. The last thing we heard coming out of our mother's womb, and the first thing upon our arrival was the sound of pain. Life is a gift and a wonder to behold, but along the way, we experience pain. The pain of disappointments, the pain from a chaotic change that disrupts our life. Pain in broken relationships, pain in relationships we believed would last forever, come to a heart-wrenching end. The pain that comes from loss of a job, loss of finances, loss of friends, loss of dreams. And yet we are taught to believe, to say, we know all things work to good to them that love the Lord. In life's tough moments, when those unexpected letdowns and calamities, unbearable sorrows happen, we do our best to remain hopeful, and rightly so. We've seen the past, how a loss of a job thrusted us into a new career and a much better and brighter future. We can testify of experiencing the unforeseen end of a relationship only to watch it lead to a healthier and happier relationship. Our past history has proven time and time again, where one door closes, a new and greater adventurous door opens. And we have learned to count it all joy when we go through trials and tribulations, that within time, we are better for it. And there's no doubt, we know that God can take what was made for evil and turn it into good, making harm into harmony. The scriptures and the positive quotes about trusting God in difficult times have become plaques hanging on our walls and perhaps even a screensaver on our computer. The quotes and verses come easily out of our mouth, even when encouraging others especially, and we repeat them again and again when we face unfavorable situations. But let's speak to those issues in our life that carry deep pain, nagging and persistent pain, to which there is no reason for these things to have happened, pain that stirs troubling questions that haunt and taunt us in the dark places of our soul. We've become numb in number to the dull pain, but it persists nonetheless and insists on tainting our trust in God. Occasionally, a sermon, a story, a testimony comes our way and we're encouraged and momentarily relief is felt. But soon the pain returns. Unanswered questions troll our soul. We try to faith our way through it, but fear creeps in and we sense an uncomfortable wavering. This pain is what I want to address, and by God's grace, I want to help you discover the pearls in your pain. Here's our text. Jesus is teaching in short parables, and he says these words. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls, who when he has found one pearl of great price, went, sold all that he had, and bought it. That's Matthew 13, 45 and 46. What could this pearl of great price be? What about this pearl would make it so valuable that Christ would encourage us to sell everything we own just to buy this one pearl? What mystery lies between the lines of this parable that Christ spoke of? I think we will come to understand this secret, this amazing truth, in the next few moments. But first, what is a pearl? What and why would Christ use this metaphor, this word picture, to make such a staggering, if not stunning, statement? The mystery begins to unfold with this intriguing fact. Pearl is the only jewel which is the product of living matter. You see, a pearl is the response of an oyster or a clam reacting to something that causes it injury or is an irritation. A pearl grows out of hurt, out of pain. A little particle of sand or something irritating, a substance, gets inside the shell of the oyster and, like cracker crumbs in bed, constantly irritating. The oyster has no hands to brush the irritant out, no means of defense except to transform that thing that is injuring or irritating it. And here's what lies at the core of this message. Adapting and allowing our pain, those intense irritation and injuries to our soul, to take on form and transform them into a pearl of great price. This mission is both elusive and yet is inclusive in its purpose. This transformation is hard. The pearls in our pain are not easily revealed, but they are unveiled slowly, surely. And that unveiling comes by diligence and discernment. But what I speak of is not just any pain. I'm not talking about those problems that, though uncomfortable and discomforting, do eventually become resolvable. No, in fact, even now the purpose of your pain remains a mystery and the misery lingers unmercifully. I think about my wife, Jeannie. The day after her 20th birthday, she faced a horrific tragedy. Her mother, Fancy, who had suffered with cancer for over 5 years, died. It was devastating for her, her father, her 5 siblings, including a 5-year-old brother. The first question was, why didn't God heal her? They had prayed and with faith, and they were fervent in their tenaciousness, in their quest to see a miracle. But it did not happen as they had hoped and as they had believed. Then the weeks turned into months and then into years. The questions continued to mount and go unanswered. What possible good could come of this tragedy? All the scriptures and cliches were spoken repeatedly. Temporary comfort was felt, but the nagging questions went undealt. And over the next couple of decades, the family fell apart, trouble, confusion, loss, 2 premature deaths of siblings at a very young age. And without being too personal, the family faced constant painful division and derailment. The attempt to assimilate and articulate any meaning, any good, any virtue, any value in her mother's death was in vain. And even though we, my wife and I, are ministers, and we both have legacies of faith, still the irritation would not go away. Like that pebble of sand inside the oyster, without hands or feet to remove it, Jeannie would have to discover the pearl in her pain. We certainly learn that some questions are easier to live with than the answers. The answer would be found in the pearl. Well, by now you may be asking, when am I going to make the great reveal? Just what is this pearl of great price? What makes it so valuable that selling everything one would have that Christ challenged us to do? Well, from an economical standpoint, selling everything for one thing can only mean it must be worth more than one's accumulated wealth. You sell $100,000 worth of assets for a pearl worth, say, $200,000 or more. Now that's good business. Christ would expect nothing less. But we know this value which Christ speaks of is not of material wealth. What is this pearl? Let me give you a hint. In the amazing book of the Revelation of Jesus Christ, a poetic book of the unveiling of Christ in His kingdom way, in a language of mystical and marvelous metaphors, John, in speaking of heaven, describes the holy city as having 12 gates, each having a solid pearl at its entrance gate. The first thing one sees upon entering this vision of eternity is pearls. Listen to what Revelation describes. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Each one of the gates was a single pearl. And the street of the city was pure gold, like transparent glass. I believe this is God's way of showing us that those painful, unfair, unjustified, unexplainable, apprehensible experiences that were never understood or attempted to be explained and known why here on earth were recognized and rewarded with meaning and value found only in eternity, in heaven. The pearl is eternity. And specifically, the pearl is an eternal perspective. The pearl is in us owning the truth of heaven as our eternal home. And that eternity, the equalizer of all things and events and experiences on earth that don't make sense. From a temporary view, they don't make sense. But the pearl is the ability to see things through the lens of eternity. To begin with the end in mind. You see, when one obtains an eternal perspective, when one comes to value and envision life through eternal eyes, when one learns and lives by eternalizing everything, everything becomes more meaningful. Eternity gives us a perspective to see through things and the perseverance to see things through. The Apostle Paul tells us about the pearl of eternity in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, 16 through 18. And in his description of eternity, gives us grounds for confidence and courage when we face those difficult, not easy to understand trials and the pressures of the present time. He says, therefore, we do not lose heart. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Paul captured the remedy to evil and suffering in Romans 8, 18, when he says, I consider that the suffering of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4, 17, the light momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. We read some more of Paul's writings in 2 Corinthians 11, 24 through 28. He writes, 5 times I received at the hands of the Jews, the 40 lashes less one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. A night and a day I was adrift at sea on frequent journeys in dangers from rivers, dangers from robbers, dangers from my own people, danger from Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the wilderness, danger at sea, danger from false brothers, in toil and hardship, through many sleepless nights and hunger and thirst, often without food and in cold and exposure. And apart from all of these things, the daily pressure on me of my anxiety for all the churches. Wow, what pastors go through, right? For Paul, to call these light and momentary says a great deal about the glory he was comparing them to. Indeed, some suffering weighs so heavily. The Holocaust, war, rape, human trafficking, torture, children dying of leukemia and cancer and starvation, personal loss that has never been recovered, weighty issues that are beyond our ability to communicate and beyond our ability to comprehend. The pearl is the great discovery of recognizing temporal is just that, temporary. What is seen, tasted, felt, smelt, heard, dealt by our five senses cannot possibly appraise accurately life's true worth and value. Only through eternal eyes, to be able to see beyond here and now, and to perceive the greater value. Job, who suffered unthinkably and experienced intense and insane injury, said in Job 28:18, "The price of wisdom is above pearls." The pearl is knowing that temporary is out of order. Rarely can life be described in its true value through the temporal. I once heard recently of a billionaire who has basically been imprisoned in his home for several years now. He's become a prisoner of his own success and wealth. The temporary has his life out of order. If only he could obtain the pearl of great price, he would see everything through eternity. His wealth would be a means to bringing meaning to so many and to do so many meaningful good for eternity. Paul urges the wealthy. They are to do good, he says, to be rich in good work, to be ready to be generous and ready to share, thus storing up treasures for themselves for a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of that which is truly life. You see, only in recognizing eternity can you actually see value here and now. Eternalize everything. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on the earth. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's Colossians 3, verse 2 and 17. In other words, everything we do should be connected to eternity. We are better off to sell everything we have and obtain an eternal perspective than to live a life appraised and valued by only what can be seen with our temporary lens. This pearl will help us avoid what I call temporal tantrums. Paul said, if in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of all people to be pitied. People often say, well, I know some people are so heavenly minded, they're no earthly good, but I disagree. Maybe one can be too spiritually minded. We all know people who talk so spiritual that they're weird. They don't make sense and have little practical application to their talk. Now, if you don't know one, you might, well, we'll leave that alone. But when one studies history's greatest world changers, it's a fact that those who lived their lives in the light of eternity and with heaven, they are the ones who have had the most positive impact on earth for humanity. Heaven and eternity, it's not just a place, and it is, but it's also a perspective. And when you have a promise of heaven and a perspective of eternity, you tap into a power that releases life fully loved and lived. To the degree which we align ourselves with correct principles, divine endowments will be released within our nature to enable us to fulfill the complete measure of our creation. It's been said, we're not human beings having a spiritual experience. We are spiritual beings having a human experience. Our humanity is fully lived with divinity leading the way. Eternity is not just a quantity of living, but a quality of living. And the more we are aware of eternity, the greater awareness of our human experiences and of its true meaning. Paul said in Philippians, if there be any virtue. Like a detective, we inspect with expectation all things that we might find the pearl of great price. In Romans 8:28, Paul wrote, we know that those who love God, that all things work to good. This verse tells us that we will one day in retrospect, that which works backwards and turns agony into glory. Eternal perspective is retrospect, and it enables us to see everything differently. It's why we can call the worst day in all of history Good Friday. Faith is like a forward memory, allowing us to believe as if what was promised has already happened. Here's the question I'm asking you today. How long will it take living with God in eternity before we'll be able to say, at last, all that suffering, all those questions were worth it? 5 seconds? 5 minutes? 5 years? I personally think in a twinkling of an eye, we will see eternal perspective. Let me ask you to think with me for a moment. Take a list of all the bad things that have happened to you and list them. Then list the best things that you have experienced in your life. You'll be astonished by how many of the best things came out of the worst things. So trust God to do the same with things that don't yet make sense. In the hands of a God of grace, our suffering will give birth to future happiness beyond our wildest dreams. Jesus said our sorrows will turn into joy, not just to be followed by joy, but transformed into joy, John 16:20. Think of it, for God's children, what is now pain will ultimately be transfigured into both glory and joy. Philippians 3:20-21 says, but our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like His glorious body by the power that enables Him to subject all things to Himself. Today, I'm asking you to buy into the eternal hope and heaven. Let's place at the forefront of our mind and our motives that there's more to life than this. There's more to life than now. I want you to feel the tension of eternity tugging at your heart. There's more. Let the Spirit feel the breeze from the crystal sea, reminding you of your eternal home. Be filled today with the presence of your Heavenly Father. Let the eternity that God placed in your heart resonate with the eternity in heaven. You'll endure challenges longer. You'll dream bigger and beyond. You'll forgive quicker and with more grace. You'll love deeper. You'll love wider. You'll love yourself from a view of eternity. Let me pray for you. I know that as I was speaking these words to you, I could hear the Holy Spirit saying to me, I'm going to heal my people. I believe that some of my words, though meant and will be encouraging, stirred up things inside of you that you thought have long been suppressed. And perhaps we opened them up a bit. And in that vulnerable moment, I'm asking you to let eternity reveal to you that there are some problems that can be fixed and resolved, that there are some questions that can be answered. But we will all carry certain experiences in our life. And when we can see those issues, those problems, those pain, as something that when given time and given trust, we can turn that pain into pearls. Pearls of a great price. Pearls of which once you obtain and embrace, will not only give you hope for the future in eternity, but will actually improve the quality and the value of the life you live now. So I speak in the name of Jesus Christ that God would supernaturally, yes, remove, resolve those issues that are troubling you. But those that don't seem to go away, those lingering questions that you cannot seemingly release, that nag and nudge and persistently insist on reminding you of that pain, that God will, as it were, just like with that oyster, allow that fluid of healing to transform that pain into a pearl. I'm speaking to you. I'm speaking healing to you. I'm believing that the pearl of great price is the understanding of living life through the light and lens of eternity. Now, if you haven't given your life to Christ, or if you've drifted from the Lord and your heart is cold towards God, I want to give you an opportunity to make Jesus Christ your Lord, to have a fresh start. Just pray this prayer with me. Lord Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. You died on the cross for my sins. I repent of my sins, and I make you my Lord and Savior. That simple prayer, friends, opens you up to a whole new life. Both the gift of eternity is yours, and the perspective of eternity is yours. There's information on the screen. We'd love to help you take your next step. We can't wait to see you in church, and we love your comments on whatever platform you're watching this. It encourages us. We read them, we watch them, we pray. Until next time, we love you. God bless you.